But for those of you that have been praying and concerned about my condition, I will be having surgery the 12th of April, and I would appreciate your continued prayer concerning that. Okay? That's got everything taken care of, and we're just right on time. This morning, we're going to be continuing our study as we left off last week with Romans. Romans chapter 8. We're going to be looking at verses 12 through 17. So if you want to turn there in your Bibles and you can read along with me. Romans 8, verse 12. He says, "So then, brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh." Last week, we closed our study with Paul speaking about the fact that he raised Jesus from the dead, and he who raised Jesus from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies through the Spirit who indwells you. Now, we talked last week about this referring to the resurrection of the Christians from the dead. The time when Christ will come and turn the mortal bodies into immortal bodies will take place at the rapture of the church. And we know that, we've talked about that a lot in our studies in the past, that this will take place prior to the tribulation period, the last 7 years. And the dead Christians whose spirits have gone to be with the Lord when they died, and the living Christians at that time will be given resurrection bodies, and they will be a body just like Jesus has now. And so last week when we were studying verse 11, we made that application of that verse, and we made it clear that then that this is referring to the mortal body of the believer being brought into immortality. And so they will receive then the heavenly resurrected body just like Jesus has the heavenly resurrected body now. And there's no doubt about the fact that what we saw in verse 11, that is what is being spoken of in verse 11. But at the same time, there's another meaning that is being brought out in verse 12 today. And the other aspect is that the believer will be given life to their mortal bodies through the Spirit who indwells them. Now, this is talking about presently. 2 Corinthians 4:11 says this, "For we who are alive are constantly being delivered over to death for Jesus' sake." Now listen to this. "So that the life of Jesus also may be manifested in our mortal bodies." So this is clearly talking then about the application of it in verse 12. Now let me read 12 again. It says, "So then, brethren, we are under obligation not to the flesh to live according to the flesh." So what we need to realize then from this, that this teaching is applied in two ways. When the mortal body will be empowered by the Spirit and enabled to win victory, it's going to be fulfilled at two different times. One would be the rapture, when all the dead and living saints are caught up to heaven to be with the Lord. But the other applies to now in the Christian life, and is referring then to the power of the Holy Spirit who lives within a Christian, being able then to give power and victory over sin. So both aspects are very important. One we look for as something ahead of us, and the other we are to anticipate as believers, that something that we should experience each day in our lives. So this is the power then given to the believer to enable them within their fleshly body to actually be indwelt by the Holy Spirit and walk in victory over sin by the Holy Spirit. So verse 12 then is saying, "Brethren, we're under obligation not to the flesh." That'd be talking about giving and yielding to the body of sin and the flesh and the law. But instead, we are under no obligation to serve in the flesh. In other words, the believer is not any longer bound by the flesh and bound by the law and bound by sin, as is the case before a person accepts Christ. So just remember that this is talking about a dual purpose here, and it is a major, powerful promise to us as believers now, as well as looking forward to that resurrection at the time of the rapture. So I think it will benefit us to keep both of those meanings in mind. Now verse 13. He says, "For if you are living according to the flesh, you must die. But if by the Spirit you're putting to death the deeds of the body, you will live." Now, this is an important verse of Scripture here. And Paul continues with this line of thinking. And he's saying, if you are living then according to the flesh, if the flesh is running your life, if you're living in sin, if you're living according to the law, and we know that no one can live according to the law, but if you're trying to do that, then you must realize that you will die. And he's saying then that those who live their lives under the control of sin, under the control of the flesh, he's simply saying then that they're headed to death. Now, death will come in two ways in the meaning here. First of all, spiritual death, which is separation from God now. Okay? So there's that aspect of it. The other aspect would be spiritual death, which is separation from God that will last throughout all eternity. So he's talking here then about this situation. And we need to see what he's saying here. So, those who live their lives under the control of sin and the flesh are not believers. And they are headed to death now and death eternally, meaning spiritual death separated from God. Now, on the other side of this, if by the Holy Spirit a person is putting to death the deeds of the body, then he's saying they will live. Those who are right with God and are overcoming sins in their life, overcoming the sin of the flesh, then he's saying they will live. So those who live in victory over sin show themselves to be true believers and are experiencing eternal life now, as the Spirit of God indwells them and gives them power and authority to overcome the flesh now, as well as the spending of eternity in heaven with God forever. So this is an important truth that we need to understand. And it will give us information that we can make an evaluation of where we are spiritually. And it's very black and white. There's not a gray area being shown here. It's a very black or white area. And the information given will show a certain person that you're dead. You're without Christ. And you need to get saved so you can be born again, so you can be made alive in the Spirit and be right with God. So then on the other side of that, it gives the assurance and the positive note to those that have been saved through faith in Christ that you now have victory over sin. Now, this is not talking about, as we've talked about many times before, coming to a place that you're perfect on this earth. But it is referring to overcoming more sin and more sin and more sin in your life as a Christian. Our lives should be lived as Christians by the power of the Holy Spirit within us. And by that power, as we yield to the Spirit, then the goal is, and the thing that we can look forward to and expect to experience, is the fact that we will begin to win greater and greater and greater victory over sin instead of being defeated by sin. So keep these two separate. They're very important truths for those that might be lost and for those that are saved. Now look at verse 14. It says, "For all who are being led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God." Now, this is in agreement with another passage of Scripture, Galatians 5:18, that says, but if you're led by the Spirit, you're not under the law. And we talked a lot about that transition in the last couple of weeks, that when you're in right relationship with God, then you are in the Spirit. You're led by the Holy Spirit. And in that situation, you're no longer under the law. The law doesn't have power and authority over you any longer. But now you're under the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. And that's the position that God wants us to come to. And this is the position He would like every lost person to come to. And those who are Christians that are not fulfilling that victorious life yet, then He wants you to know that this is what's available, and this is what His goal for you on the earth would be right now, and that is simply walking in victory over sin. And as you overcome one area of sin, then God will reveal another area. And so we just continue this procession or progress throughout our Christian life. Overcome, 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 overcome. And as we do that, then we become sanctified. We become set apart unto God. And we're in positions then to have greater victory over sin. Now, let's look at 15. He says, for you have not received the spirit of slavery leading to fear again, but you have received a spirit of adoption as sons, by which we cry out, Abba, Father. The born-again Christian no longer has a spirit of slavery unto the law and sin that results then in fear. Instead, the born-again Christian has received the spirit of adoption as sons. Now, this is an important term. The spirit of adoption makes the believer sons of God. And of course, this is referring to sons of God and daughters of God. Makes them in right relationship with God. And in that position, we're in a position connected with the Father so that we can cry out Abba or Father to Him. And we'll talk more about that in just a minute. But in the first century, when Paul was writing and using this terminology of adoption of a son or adoption into God, then adoption at that point in time was, let's say a father was going to adopt, or a man was going to adopt a son, then he would adopt that son deliberately, choosing that child to be an adoptive son to the father, in which he would perpetuate the father's name. Now listen to this. And he would inherit the father's estate. And the adopted son would have the same position as any natural born children in a regular family relationship. Now, even in our day, and I've learned this, but Blaine and I have, because of having adopted grandchildren, when the adoption is finalized, the birth certificate is changed on the child that's been adopted, and they're given the adopted family name. That's how strong and powerful and real adoption is. And so that's being used here to talk about the adoption that takes place when a person recognizes their sin, turns from their sin, and accepts Christ as Lord and Savior. They are adopted then into the family of God. And we must realize then that that's the only way that anyone is going to be in the family of God. Except by adoption, there's no other way to be brought in. Now, this word Abba, this is an Aramaic term that was used in that day by the Jewish children to refer to their earthly father. So it was a very special name, something that a child would say to his father. And so it's Abba Father is the way it's translated here. And some believe that because this is being used in the Gentile church, as we see here, that very possibly this came from Jesus when he was on the earth, and he using the term Abba to refer to someone's earthly father, or as in the case it would be for him, would be his spiritual father. So this is a word, I guess you would say, that is a very affectionate word that is being used here to refer to the Father. So this is pointing out the kind of relationship that the Christian is going to have with the Heavenly Father. It's just like a loving earthly father that you would go into and say Pop or Dad or whatever little name that, you know, children will come up with to name their grandfather or father or mother or whatever. There's a lot of times people will get a name just by the first words that a child can say. And so from then on, you know, that person's Papa or whatever it is. But that's what's being spoken of here. It's a name of great familiarity. It's a name that the Christian can use because now they're adopted child of God and they're full-fledged children of God. And so in that condition, we can speak to God in that open relationship like a child to a loving earthly father here. So this is what Paul is wanting to show in the meaning of this word here. Now, verse 16, he says, the Spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are children of God. The Holy Spirit, he's saying, testifies. Or another way of saying this is, bears witness with our born-again human spirit that we're children of God. And we know that we are made up of body, soul, and spirit. And once we commit sin, we become dead spiritually, and our connection with God is broken. Now, the only thing that can restore that is to come to a relationship with God through faith in Christ. And when that happens, then the restoration comes in terms of being born again spiritually into the family of God. And so that enables the person then to be considered then a child of God. Now, in verse 14, it refers to a child of God or children of God. But notice in verse 16, look back at that again. In verse 14, it's talking about sons of God. And then in chapter 16, it's talking about children of God. Now, what we need to understand from that is simply this. They're both referring to the same thing. There's no distinction between son of God or children of God. We all become children of God through adoption into the family of God. So that's important for us to realize they both mean the same thing. But there is a point of clarification that we need to make here. And it's simply this. You've probably heard people make a statement, well, we're all children of God. That's not a true biblical statement. We're not all children of God. The only ones that are children of God are those who have come to faith in Jesus and been adopted into the family of God. We are all God's creation, but we're not all children. Those without Christ are not children of God at this present time. Now, they can come to faith in Christ and become children adopted into the family. But don't be misled by people who would try to say, well, we're all children of God, so God loves us, and we're just going to all go to heaven when we die. That's not true. A huge portion of the population of the world will go to hell and spend eternity in hell. And the thing that will determine that is the fact that they have not come to the place that they were adopted into the family of God And then the Spirit of God began to operate in their life, giving them victory over sin, and then ultimately coming to the place that they would be raptured up with their heavenly resurrection body to be forever in heaven with God. So we need to realize that the spirit of the person that's saved is born again. It is totally connected with God. It has received all the redemption it's ever going to receive. It is as right with God as it can ever be. But as we've talked about before, that leaves the body, which is fleshly, and the soul, which is the mind, will, and emotions. That leaves those two in the physical realm. And so what has to happen is, as Christians, we have to learn and be aware of the fact that now, through faith in Christ, we are born again spiritually. And the will of God and the potential for each one of us is now to overcome sin in our fleshly body and with our fleshly soul, which is our mind, will, and emotions. And so the Spirit of God wants to live in us and through us so that we can overcome those two areas that are still in the flesh and overcome to the point that we become more victorious and more victorious, as we saw earlier. So this is a very important thing for us to understand, because always until we're raptured up into heaven with God, when we're alive on this earth as Christians, we're going to be born again spiritually, but we're going to be dealing with a body that's fleshly and a soul that's fleshly. And so what has to happen is the spirit of man has to be under the control of the Holy Spirit who lives in that Christian. And then they take control over the flesh and over the soul, and make the flesh and the soul come into a line with God's will, and that is live in righteousness. Okay? So the way it is with most people now, well, with all people that are lost, their body and their soul are ruling their spirit. Okay? And this is the situation when you find a person who's born again through faith in Christ, but they haven't grown or matured. They're not in the position of yielding to the Spirit and allowing the Spirit to work in them. And so what's happening is they have the Spirit that's of God and it's born again. But at that point, they have a flesh that's running their life. They have a soul, mind, will, and emotions that's running their life. And so the lost are in a situation in which the fleshly mind and the fleshly body, they're living according to the dictates of the mind and the body. Okay? But when you become born again through faith in Christ, now you have the Holy Spirit. And what is expected is now the Spirit, our spirit being under the control of the Holy Spirit, should now take authority over the body and dictate to the body what it does and doesn't do, and dictate to the soul what it does and doesn't do. And that's the only way that the body and the soul can be overcome. Otherwise, they're going to be in charge. And when the body and the soul is running your life, then you're living in sin. And the outcome of that, if it doesn't change, is death. But God has provided the way out, and it is through faith in Christ, which then enable that person to begin to walk by the Spirit so that they would be able to overcome the sins of the flesh in the body and in the soul of the mind, will, and emotions. Does that make sense? Okay. A lot of people don't understand that, and it's really very, very important that we understand that. And that we understand that of what is available to us as Christians. A lot of people get saved, they don't know these other truths, and they just live the rest of their life with their flesh controlling them. and gaining no victory over sin, and they're just sort of stuck in a certain place. And God doesn't want that. God wants His adopted children to move as far into sanctification and holiness and being set apart unto Him as is possible in that person's life in the years that they have on this earth. So, brings us back to that thing we said before. We can't say, well, I'm still in the flesh, so I'm going to sin, and that's okay because God knows I'm still in the flesh and I'm going to sin, so I'll just sin and not worry about it. Anybody with that attitude is not saved, because that attitude would not be in the spirit of the born-again Christian. The born-again Christian is not looking at grace like, okay, I'm home free now, so I can sin all I want. The born-again Christian is looking at it and realizing, by God's grace, I've been forgiven, and now my desire is to live for God, not live in sin. So, you see the point here. If you're living in sin, and that's the direction your life's going, that's the drive within you and behind you, then you can know you're lost. But if you're living in right relationship with God, you're going to want to put away the sin in your life. You're going to want to overcome it. And God is saying, you have the power to do that because my spirit lives inside of every born-again child of God. And that spirit can give you the power to walk in greater and greater victory over sin and sanctification. And so this is where we should be. This is what we should know. And this is what we should be living in as Christians. And the song we sang a while ago, you know, all the things that you can do because of Him that lives in you. And this is the truth of Scripture. And it's the power of the Word of God to transform the Christian's life. Now, I've spent so many years as a Christian living without this knowledge, without any understanding like this. And what was ruling my life, even though I was saved, what was ruling my life was my body and my soul. My spirit was just overpowered by my body and my soul. And I wish I could have learned this truth years and years earlier, that that's not the way it's supposed to be, and that God wants it to be the other way. But the truth is, I didn't even know I had a body, a soul, and a spirit. You know, I mean, I didn't know enough about any of it to know what it was supposed to be like. And a lot of people fall into that category. But we no longer have an excuse, at least those of us here now, because you're hearing the truth. And so now you know what you're capable of doing by the Holy Spirit. Now, let's finish up with verse 17. He says, and if children, listen to this, heirs also, heirs of God and fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him, so that we may also be glorified with Him. Now, this is a powerful verse of Scripture, and it's fully packed with good information. Paul is making it clear that if we are children of God, then we are heirs of God. Now, an heir is, we're back to what we were talking about a while ago, the adopted son would be the heir of the father that adopted him, okay? And in the same case here, we're adopted into the family of God through faith in Jesus, and now we're heirs of God. Now, Jesus is an heir of God, we see here. And He's an heir by nature and from all eternity. But every born-again Christian is a child of God and an heir of God by adoption into the family of God. So we're back to that same thing again. I mean, you have the full status as a child of God as Jesus Himself in terms of what you're going to inherit. He goes on and says that. So the children of God are fellow heirs with Christ. And that's exactly what's being said there. That whatever Jesus inherits throughout all eternity, every born-again Christian will inherit. Because not only are we an heir of God through faith in Christ, but we're joint heirs with Christ. And it's almost beyond our imagination to think that we as sinners respond to the grace of God, be forgiven, receive the Spirit of God, be born again in the Spirit, and then have this opportunity to defeat the enemy in our lives here on earth, and then ultimately go and be in heaven with God and experience the same blessings throughout all eternity as Jesus, who is the Son of God, not adopted, but the Son of God, is going to experience. And, you know, it's just like, how can it be true? But it is true. And so this is what God wants us to realize, that this is the position we're in when we come to faith in Christ. So there are so many things that happen when a person gets saved. It's just overpowering if you try to understand and start walking in all of it all of a sudden. And thankfully, God doesn't expect that. I mean, He knows that we're going to have to learn and grow and mature. But that doesn't give us the opportunity to just say, well, that sounds too hard. I'll just fall back on my right relationship with God through faith in Him and just hang around until time to die, and then I'll go to heaven and be with Him. That is not the proper attitude. And the true born-again committed Christian will never have that attitude. Okay? A lot of people say it's a really bad thing to teach what the Bible has to say, that when a person is born again through faith in Christ, that they are saved and they'll never be lost again. Their concern is that people will say, wow, what a deal. I'm just going to go sin all I want to. And that's what they don't understand. The born-again Christian does not want to sin anymore. There's not a desire to sin anymore. The desire is, God, help me overcome this wretched body that I'm in, because it's leading me to do things I don't want to do. That's not who I am anymore. And so we need to realize that. Now, notice there's a condition here. Now, this is really cool. There's a condition. Let me read it again. It says, and if children, heirs, also heirs of God, and fellow heirs of Christ. We've already talked about that. But then there's a condition. And the condition is this: if indeed we suffer with Him, so that we may also be glorified with Him. Now, this condition is very important. And we must realize that those radio and TV evangelists that you hear sometimes that say that when you're a Christian and you're serving God, your life is just a bed of roses. It's just one promotion after another. It's just moving from one fabulous home to a $6 million estate, from one Piper Cub to a Learjet, and you know, suits in the closet that you're wearing that are worth thousands and thousands of dollars, and you can walk around and talk about how expensive they are, and the fact that you have more hanging in the closet that have not even had the tags removed from it yet. And this teaching that that's what every Christian should expect. That's not biblical. It's not biblical at all. There is going to be suffering in the Christian life. And we see it right here. The truth is this: most people who get saved, they realize that there's more suffering in their life after salvation than before salvation. You say, well, what kind of deal is that? It's the real deal, and it's the truth. There are times in which the Christian struggles far more than they did as a lost person. Why? Because as a lost person, it was easy to live in sin. And there was nothing trying to stop them living in sin. They loved it. Just to get up every day and live in sin. But once they became born again through faith in Jesus, all of that's changed. And when that person lives in sin, the Heavenly Father is going to discipline them. Just like you would discipline a child. And it's because they are His children and He loves them that He doesn't want to leave them walking in the sin they're in. So He's going to punish them to bring them to the right walk with Him. And that's difficult. It's not fun to be punished by God. Therefore, the lost person doesn't experience any of that. So that person gets saved, and they are out here going on living the way they were living before, and they find out, whoa, all my friends are living this way. Everything's fine with them, but man, I'm being just traumatized here. I'm just, there's something happening with me that I just don't understand. Because God is spanking you, and He will continue to spank you until you quit living that way and start living the way He wants you to. Now, that's not a bad thing. It's a good thing. But it's important for us to know that. And so we need to realize that the Scripture is very plain, that the born-again Christian is going to have trials, tests, tribulations, difficulties. Why? Because faith must be tested to be proven true. And faith must be tested in order to build stronger faith. It's just like going to the gym and pumping iron to build muscles. Well, that's the same thing in the Christian life. The fact that there's this situation in which there are trials, there are tests, there are tribulations in the Christian life, that's the pumping iron in the spirit realm of the Christian life. That makes your faith stronger. And that makes you stronger. And it makes you come to a place to realize these things we're talking about this morning. Starting to appreciate having victory over sin and really desiring that and really moving toward that and wanting to lay hold of that in your Christian life. So, that's what we're seeing here. And so, this is real, the fact that Christians will suffer. And sometimes the Christian is suffering because they are being spanked by God because they're not living right. And God's going to use that to bring them to the place they start living right and learn that they can't do what they've been doing. And that's part of it. But there are other aspects of it also. And so it's important for us to realize all of this. And one of the things that has to be realized is, if we're going as a Christian to be, and we're adopted into the family, we're going to have victory now through the power of the Holy Spirit who lives in us. And now we're children of God. And we're going to face a certain amount of difficulty here in this life, a certain amount of suffering. And that's normal Christianity. And so we must realize that, and we must anticipate that, and we must receive that in the right understanding when that happens to us. So, in order then to be fully glorified, as will happen to the Christian, there must be first suffering. Let's read it again. And if children, heirs, also heirs of God, fellow heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with Him, so that we may also be glorified with Him. So that's a big if. Now, similar thing is being said in 2 Corinthians 4:16. It says, though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. He means here that the same afflictions which destroy the outward man are the means by which the Spirit of God uses to renew more and more the inward man. And so there's a purpose here for all of this. Now, we come down to putting this together then, we need to realize then that the true believer, the true born-again Christian, is expected to win victory over sin. This is what God expects, and this is what we should expect of ourselves. Why? Because we've been changed. We've been born again spiritually. We have the Holy Spirit living in us. Our whole attitude toward what we want and what we don't want is changed. And so the Spirit of God can give us that opportunity to increase in our victory over sin. And so every one of us should expect that, and we should know that God expects that. And God does not expect anything of us that He doesn't give us the power to accomplish. So He gives us the Holy Spirit, who can bring all of that to pass in our life. And so then we start to live that way. Now at the same time that we're experiencing this victory over sin, the Christian must realize that we're also supposed to be filling up that which is lacking of the sufferings of Christ. And that's in agreement with what Paul is saying here. As Christians, there's going to be a certain amount of suffering in our life. It's the normal Christian life. It's what we should expect. But we should not see it negatively like most of us have seen it. Oh, why is this happening to me? I must not be lost, or God must be really mad at me, or whatever like that. No, this is normal. This is normal. If you're going to have a strong faith, it's got to be tested. And it's got to be tested by something that's powerful enough to really test it. Does that make sense? So, then there will be this suffering that will go along. But, as we'll see in our beginning verse next week, is simply this. The suffering that we face now as a Christian is nothing. Nothing even remotely close to the glory that we will have throughout all eternity with God. Put it together. You're a Christian. You're going to suffer. What are you suffering? You're suffering to fill up that which is lacking in the sufferings of Christ. And it requires suffering with Him before you're glorified with Him. Okay? So, hopefully this is something that can be seen and understood. Now, if you're not a Christian, then you're living with your flesh and your mind controlling your life. And the flesh and the mind is wanting to do fleshly, sinful things. And so you're living in sin. And up until this point, you've been pretty happy about it. But now you're hearing the truth that God is beginning to convict you of sin and show you there's another way. And so if you find that you're living in sin and you sense the Spirit of God drawing you, then you need to respond to the Spirit of God and by faith in Him be adopted into the family of God today, so that you can leave here with the Holy Spirit living in you. And you can begin to walk out the Christian life God wants you to walk out. Victory over sin, victory over sin, victory over sin throughout the rest of your Christian life. So you may need to accept Christ today. If you're here and you know you're saved and you're experiencing this discipline, this difficulty in your life that is being brought against you and you don't understand why, then it's one of two reasons if you're a Christian. One is you're living wrong and God is chastening you to get you to see the wrong way you're going to come into the right way. Okay? Or the other could be you're going along and you're doing pretty good and God is allowing these things to come into your life because He wants to test your faith, which makes it stronger, so you'll become a stronger and stronger Christian. So if you're in that situation, you may have need of a recommitment of your Christian life. You may have need of wanting the prayer team to pray with you about some areas that you're struggling in. And get a hold of this understanding and begin to live it out in your life as a Christian. Now, if you're here, you've been saved, you know you've been saved, but you've never followed Jesus in water baptism. One of the things that he will do in your life is he's going to discipline you if you're refusing to do that. Because it's a very important thing for you to do, and he wants you to do that. It is your public confession of faith in Christ. That's what water baptism is. And Jesus said, if you will confess me before the Father which is in heaven, I will confess you before, if you will confess me before men, I will confess you before the Father which is in heaven. And so this public confession of your faith in Christ is important. And it should be done as soon as you can do it after becoming a Christian. And only then will you see your Christian life begin to move forward like it should. So you may have that commitment that you need to make. Or you may just have other needs today that the prayer team will be back at the right at the close of the service, prepared to pray with you and for you about any commitment or any need that you have, whether it would be spiritual, physical, emotional, financial, whatever. They're prepared and ready by the Spirit of God to meet your need in that way. Also, our offering bucket is to my left. If you'd like to participate in the ministry of this church, then we invite you to drop in your tithes and offerings. I hope that you've heard something today that is going to move you a little further down the way with your walk with God. And whatever it is that the Spirit has been speaking to you about this morning, as he used the Word of God to speak to you, then you need to act on that today. You don't need to put it off. You need to act on it today. Because if you do, then that thing that's missing in your life, you can lay hold of that next step today and be brought into a relationship and a place with God better than you've ever been before. God bless you. Thank you for being here. I hope I made it clear enough. And if not, you can come by and talk to me. I'd be glad to try to restate something to make it clearer if need be. Have a great rest of the day. You're dismissed.